today, there is a great, I would say, indispensable need for fearless voices in the world of writing and literature. We need critical voices of writers, artists, and public intellectuals raised in, whenever we need it, raised in support, defense, and dissent. In recent times, one such voice, which has not only been raised, but has been heard, belongs to Professor A.R. Venkatachalapathy. He teaches at the Madras Institute of Development Studies in Chennai and has held research assignments in many different cities in the world, Paris, London, Cambridge, Harvard. ARV is one of those rare beings, a bilingual historian, writer, and speaker. He has been able to speak with recognizable authenticity about politics, personalities, social issues, and the cultural history of the Tamil realm. He's been able to do it in English for a different audience as well. His books in English have served the same purpose. Random examples that I can quote, which I particularly liked, would be his Tamil characters, personalities, politics, culture, for the portraits of the Dravida leaders, Periyar, C.N. Annadurai, and Karunanidhi. And the lovely titled, the beautifully titled, In Those Days There Was No Coffee, for its dissertations on on the politics of language and identity. Today, ARV will speak to us about Ponniyin Pudalvar, Sunda M.R.M. Sundaram's biography of Kalki Krishnamurthy. This is the book that I've been living with now for the past 12 months, day in and day out. Before that, this was a 1,000-page book that I relentlessly read aloud to my siblings for 4 months. No, I will not speak about Sundaram, except to say that I salute him for his rigorous research, uncompromising fact-checking, his objective vision, his refusal to eulogize, and his density of thought. Last but not the least, his inimitable style, you can say. I'm particularly happy that his daughters, Srimati Ramamani Sundar and Srimati Jaya Shankarana are here today. Please welcome. We will all listen to ARV talking about your father, and I look forward to ARV taking us through Sundar's monumental achievement with keen interest and eagerness and a great avid expectation. I invite you now, ARV, to speak about this particular subject that we have chosen for today. Over to you.
First, let me thank Gauri and her family, her siblings, for this invitation to speak about Sunda's definitive and monumental biography of Kalki. First, let me begin with a caveat. I think after Vignesh's soulful rendering of the song, my talk is going to be somewhat of a letdown. It might be very academic. It might put you off to sleep. No apologies for residents of India. This is well past 8, so you can go off to sleep. But singing a talattu for people in the US for whom it must be early morning might be quite inappropriate, but I'll try to do my best. Some of you might also be wondering why a Pudhumai Pithan Athisiya Nadu, a scholar of Pudhumai Pithan, a biographer of Periyar, has been invited to speak about Kalki's biography. But if anybody has actually seriously engaged with my work, they would have noticed that my work themes with references to Kalki's writings. And Punniyin Pudalvar is one of the most cited books in my work. This is a copy of that book, which I bought in about 1990 when the book was priced at 3500 Vanathi Padipagam. The unsold stock of that book used to be piled up there. So I got that book in those days. After I read the book, I got a copy of the book. It's a well-thumbed book. So Gauri, please get me a new edition of the book. My copy is in tatters. And if I'm also add that I have recommended this book to many people. I once recommended this book to Sundar Ramaswamy, who had not at that until that point read that book. He said, I've heard a lot about that book. I've never read it. And I recommended it highly. I also got a copy of that book. He read it and he wrote about it in very, very positive terms. And sometime last year, when the historian Ramchandra Guha approached me asking for recommendations for works of non-fiction in Tamil, which should be rendered into English, I made two recommendations. One is the other classic book, Tamil Nadil Gandhi by A. Ramaswamy. That's also a bulky book. And the other recommendation I made was Punniyin Pudalvar. So my credentials are kind of impeccable. I have more of my own trumpet to blow, but I won't do it right now. That will come up shortly. Once I start on my Seva Puranam, it won't stop. But let me just indicate that I have also made contribution to Kalki scholarship. So wait for me to tell you what my contribution is to that. I also have a sentimental attachment to this book. One of my very great friends, the scholar Pada Adhiyaman, when I first met him in June 1987, I had just joined the library, Maramaladigal Library, as librarian. Adhiyaman was working on his PhD on Vara, Ramaswamy Iyengar, and he wanted a copy of Punniyin Pudalvar. So I took out the book and gave it to him. He said, I don't want the book, but I want the bound volume of the sheets and forms from the original Kalki. If some of you might have actually seen the original version that was published in Kalki, it is full of photographs and images. Sunda first serialized it in Kalki in 74, 75, I think, and then 76 the book was published. Also, I want to add that, you know, he revised the books extensively and the pages were laid out differently. So my collaboration and friendship with Adhiyaman started with this book, this biography of Kalki. So these preliminary words, let me plunge directly into this book. Indians are very poor biographers. They are hagiographers. They deify their heroes. And they use a very non-modern language, uncritical language, to talk about their heroes. To give a Tamil, eppovume eppadi ezhuvaanga Kalki pirandhar nu ezhuthaanga, Bharathi pirandhar nu ezhuthaanga, Bharathi avadharithar, Bharathi thondrinar. You know, they are gifts from heaven. I am a social historian. I don't believe that any individual is a gift to the earth. There is only, as Pudhumaipithan famously said, there is only one way into this world. There are innumerable ways to leave this world, but there is only one.
Oh my God.
Professor Venkata Chakrapati said that he will switch to his phone if he experiences any connectivity issues. So we request you to bear with us in that time, and I'm sure he'll be back. So I request Ruby and Ruku to watch out for him.
Okay, I hope I'm audible now. Okay.
Yes.
So, Uve Swaminathaiah, Kalki, you know, there is a chapter on Swaminathaiah's, Kalki's relationship with Swaminathaiah in this book. Swaminathaiah, apart from being a great scholar, he was also a fantastic biographer, probably one of the best and earliest of Tamil biographers. He wrote a number of biographical essays, but two books are very important. One is about his senior contemporary Vidwan Thyagaraja Chettiar, but a more elaborate book about his own teacher, Mahavidwan Meenakshi Sundaram Pillai. Even though it takes on a hagiographic form, in fact, it's so hagiographic that he never refers to his teacher by his name. The only time he refers to his teacher by name is when he is named by his parents. But still, it is a work of great scholarship. The amount of research that went into it is phenomenal. He collected letters, he met his contemporaries, collected his writings, and wrote a two-volume biography. It is written in a scholarly style, but it's still a brilliant biography. Then two or three other biographies. One biography of Vallalar Ramalinga Swamigal by Ooran Adigal. Because Ooran Adigal is a monk in the Vallalar order, so it is once again hagiographical, but it is also a great work of scholarship where he collected all the manuscripts, letters, and wrote this book. A third biography I would like to mention is the biography of Maravilla Adigal by his son. There are a number of criticisms about that book, but it is a very comprehensive work which is based extensively on Maravilla Adigal's style. That's also a big book. Then there's a fourth book, which is a rival not only to Sunda, but the hero of that book is also the rival to Kalki. Pudumai Pithan Varlaru by Raghunathan. It is a short book. In many ways, it is a contrast with Sunda's book. Sunda did a lot of field work, research, took 3-4 years of research to write it. He wrote an 800-page book. Raghunathan spent exactly 4 weeks to write this book. It's a short book. But nevertheless, it is a classic. In my introduction to Pudumai Pithan Varlaru, I mentioned I have to now slip into Tamil. And I also see that, you know, Dr. Umaram is on this, is listening to me. Sunda Udaya Puttagam, I write. Nalla Sattana Agaram Saptu, Kunguma Pota Pal Kudichi, Ura Thai Kipuranda Kurandai Vanda. பொன்னியின் புதல்வர். ஆனா ரகுநாதனுடைய புத்தகம் வந்து ஒரு ஒரு வசதி இல்லாத ஒரு தாய் பெற்றெடுத்த குழந்தை, ஆனால் நிறைமாச குழந்தையின் மனப்போடு பிறந்த ஒரு குழந்தை. இந்த தேர் ஆர் திஸ் டூ கான்ட்ராஸ்ட். ஸோ இட்ஸ் வெரி இன்ட்ரெஸ்டிங் தட் தி டூ கிரேட் ரைவல்ஸ் போத் கல்கி அண்ட் புதுமை பித்தன் வேர் தி சப்ஜெக்ட் ஆஃப் தி வெரி ஃபியூ classic biographies that have ever been written in Tamil. So what is, or a more recent book, one more book that I want to add, which is I think a very important book which will become a classic, is the biography of Varadarajulu Naidu, Dr. P. Varadarajulu Naidu by Adiyamma. So with this kind of preliminary remarks, let me get to talk about the craft of this particular biography. As you can see, it's a monumental book. It's almost a doorstopper, runs at 850 pages. Sunda's book, Sunda's biography, stands out among other biographies, not only in terms of its bulk and its quality. It has all the strengths of an authorized and commissioned biography. It cuts both ways. We'll come to it, but there is no gainsaying the fact that an authorized and commissioned biography is important because it gives you access to a whole range of resources. Sunda mentions that, you know, Kalki Rajendran, Kalki's son, had actually collected much of the material. And I presume the Kalki journal, Bharathan Publications, must have funded this project because it's an expensive project. We know that there is no market, there is no literary market for biographies, works of nonfiction. So obviously, the book could not certainly have earned the money for itself. And as I told you, this 35 rupee book took 25 years to be sold. I think now it is in the second edition, it's probably cost a little more. So it is, because it is a commissioned volume, Sunda could spend, I reckon that he probably spent every waking moment for the better part of 4 years on this book. So what did he actually do? How did he go about doing it? Let us remember that Merami Sundaram was a near contemporary of Kalki. He was born in 1913 April. He knew Kalki personally. He contributed to Anandavidan and Kalki, but he started his career in a different journal. I will keep the secret for a while. I'll come back to it. I'll tell you where he first published his writings. So he was a near contemporary. So he was not an outsider. He's not a fresh greenhorn person. He's part of the same literary milieu in which Kalki functioned. So he knew the world. So he's the extensive reading into books. So that is one thing that he does. So there is a very interesting bibliography, very comprehensive bibliography. Then he looked for all the journals. Yes, Anandavigadan and Kalki would have been easy to access, but he went looking for both Navasakti, the first journal, that is Trivika's weekly journal, which was published from 1921, where Kalki starts his journalistic career. Then Sunda also traces Vimochanam, the prohibition journal that was published from Gandhi Ashram, Tiruchirappalli. So he has looked up all the journals. Then he has met more than 100 literary personalities and family members and collected material from them. And he has used the material very judiciously. But I will say that even though he met 120 people, there are one or two very glaring omissions. I will come to it once again. The secrets that I will reveal may not be as interesting and spellbinding as Punin Selvan, but I will try to maintain the suspense. He also collects all the correspondence, the extensive correspondence. In those days, not only was Kalki a good correspondent, he was friends with avid correspondents like T.K. Chidambaranath Muraiyar. So Chidambaranath Muraiyar, I think he would have probably written as many letters as Mahatma Gandhi wrote. So that would be the volume of his correspondence. So he's done that. Then, very important, Sunda did a lot of field work. As I said, Sunda is not from the Kaveri basin. Most of the writers of this first few generations of Tamil writers, they all came from two regions and from two caste groups. The two regions were the Kaveri River Basin and the Tamravarni River Basin. In terms of caste, they were all Brahmins or upper caste Velalars. It was from this universe that they came. Merami Sundaram, Melanattam, Ramachandraiyar, Meenakshi Sundaram was from Tirunelveli. He did his field work. He went to Puttamangalam, various other places. And through this field work, yes, he collected a lot of material. And for a Tamil or an Indian biography, the amount of work that he did was phenomenal. For instance, he went to the school where Kalki studied and looked up all the mark sheets, all the attendance registers, and he has given all the details from these various registers. The only thing that is missing is how many days he attended classes and how many days he bunked classes. That we don't know. And the other strength of this book, as I said, because there are not good Tamil exemplars, So where do you look for models? So K. Rajendran writes in the preface that when Sundas embarked on this project, he bought books for 200 rupees, biographies in English, which he read, and we used them as models. And coming to the literary style, you know, it is written in a very easy and clear style. I almost said facile style. I wouldn't say that, you know, it was, you know, stylistically, the book is not very distinguished. It is the more journalistic, but both the strength and weakness of the book is that, you know, it relies extensively on Kalki's own writings. Kalki, as we know, must have, except for the time when he was writing film scripts and when he was unwell, he wrote copiously. He wrote novels, short stories, columns, reviews, polemics, book reviews, letters, and in all of them, he drew extensively from his own life. Some of it he represented factually, and in some instances, he masked it in his own fiction. So Sundar draws on all these things, and he puts together all these things in a very engaging style. He says that, you know, it's not doing a chronological work, but in fact, it is chronological. Thematic treatment is in a chronological framework. And coming to, you know, the fact that, you know, how we mine the writings of Kalki, we have to remember one thing, that this book was written before Kalki's writings were compiled into various volumes. I don't know whether Suprabalan is here now in this arena. Suprabalan has done an amazing work for about 20-25 years, putting together the various scattered writings of Kalki into accessible volumes. Here is where I will blow my trumpet. Every December, after December 5th, I usually don't attend literary meetings. So after the function is over, I would go to Vanathi Padippagam and buy the two volumes that used to be published annually of Kalki's writing. This is what I've done over the last 20 years. And I think both Kalki aficionados as well as Tamil enthusiasts owe a great debt to Suprabalan for putting together all these works. So what I have done is, wherever I have found material which Suprabalan has missed, I would make photocopies of them and send it to Suprabalan. So I suppose that qualifies me for giving this talk. So this is how he has gone about doing it. Why I elaborate on this to such an extent is that, you know, this is the kind of a discipline and rigor that is very sadly missing in among Indian scholars. So biography is not written in an inspired moment. Yes, you have your inspiration, but restrict your inspiration to 1%. 99% is perspiration, legwork. You have to do your research properly. Otherwise, it will simply show. So Sundar's first achievement is this great research that goes into the book and how he puts them together in a very engaging way, appropriately titled with allusions to Kalki's own writings, and each chapter is prefaced by an interesting epigraph. And like all good biographies, any biography is the story of an individual. It is an individual in context. So this book actually provides a very good context for how this young man from a educationally privileged community, but economically underprivileged family from Puttamangalam ends up becoming a renowned writer, a popular writer, celebrated writer, the great number of fans who rub shoulders with some of the biggest personalities of 20th century, not only 20th century Tamil Nadu, but 20th century India. So the context comes out. The entire book is set out in the context of how the Indian freedom struggle plays itself out, how various personalities emerge. Obviously, you cannot talk of Kalki without Rajaji. All these things come through. Here I want to make a contrast. So you have Rajmohan Gandhi's biography of Rajaji. Excellent biography, lots of information, great fieldwork. But one thing is missing. Rajmohan Gandhi is not fluent in Tamil. So the Tamil side of Rajaji does not come through in his biography. So the great figures who played a very important role in Rajaji's life, like Rasikamani, T.K. Chidambaranath Mudaliar, and Kalki, are pale shadows or marginal figures in the Rajaji biography. We all know, you know, how unjust it is to these very important personalities. So in this book, all the figures come out in, I wouldn't say in flesh and blood, but they are very much present. Some of the personalities are not fully elaborated, but one can understand. The book is already 850 pages long. So if you go into further details, probably it might be very difficult. It would become like the biographies of American presidents written by American university professors. So Tamil people, luckily or unluckily, don't have those kind of biographies. There are some very key chapters in this book, even though this is a very, one can say, a sprawling book. But at the same time, I wouldn't say it is a baggy monster because it is well structured. Even though it is prolix, it does not sag anywhere. Very important. And as I said, especially in a context where Kalki's writings were not available. For instance, in this very book, there is a chapter where which Sundar deals wonderfully. S.S. Vasan was a great man, a big movie mogul, newspaper baron. But let us be very honest. He acted like a typical Mughalan. He was vengeful and vindictive, not only in relation to Kalki, but also in relation to Devan. We have to remember that the great writer Devan died without seeing a single book published in his lifetime, his own book. None of his books were published in his lifetime because Vasan said, Ananda Vigadan said, you wrote in Ananda Vigadan as an employee of Ananda Vigadan, so you have no rights to the your own writings, so we will not let you publish your books. So it is only 13 years after Kalki's death that his writings, the copyright to his writings, passed to the family. He handles all these things. So once again, let me emphasize that in a context where the writings of Kalki are not collected, Sunda does a yeoman service by quoting extensively from Kalki's own writings, which make it a very important resource for historians and sociologists. Then, you know, one or two other chapters I would like to mention. There are excellent chapters on his relationship with Rajaji, but I would say that, you know, the relationship between Kalki and Rajaji is the stuff for a separate book. It cannot be encapsulated or captured in a few chapters, but it figures very prominently. And we know that, you know, Kalki was, he's the mouthpiece of Rajaji, he's the advocate of Rajaji, he's the apologist for Rajaji, he's the disciple of Rajaji. One can go on about his relationship with Rajaji, one can be critical about it, but that is what it is, and I hope someday somebody would do a book like that. So I also want to refer to one or two very key chapters which are also controversial. There is one chapter on the Mahakavi controversy. Some of you might be amazed to know that there was a time when people said Bharati was not a Mahakavi. Even more curiously, you would be surprised to know that Kalki himself belonged to that camp for a while. That is a controversial chapter. I would say that, you know, Sunda has been very generous to Kalki. In that sense, in relation to how we first saw Bharati and how his views changed later. Basically, Kalki says that Bharati cannot hold a candle to Tagore or Shakespeare or Shelley or whatever. So that is his original position, but then he later changes his position. Then there is this chapter, another controversial chapter on the question of originality, influence and plagiarism in writings. Here, once again, obviously, you know, Sunda can only be on the side of Kalki. Here, I want to make a reference to my own contribution about the debate that went on between Kalki and Pudhumaipitha, a polemical debate in 1944 about the question of originality, influence, and plagiarism in the writings of Kalki. For a very long time, these writings were not compiled and published in an accessible form. In 1998, what I did was I found not only Pudhumaipithan's series of polemical writings against Kalki, but when I published it, I also included Kalki's version, Kalki's response to Pudhumaipithan's attacks. You know, I arranged it in a very sequential fashion. It was published in 1998, and Ashokamitran, for instance, and Sundar Ramaswamy also had some very good words to say. They said that you have served a very important function in literary history by not taking sides and putting together both sides. I would say that this particular chapter is a little weak, not because he takes Kalki's side, but it is because he has not looked at Pudhumaipithan's writings. What did actually Pudhumaipithan have to say? Here, I think there is one aspect of Sunda's life which many people don't know. In the, for instance, in Amuda Surabhi, Sunda's daughter wrote a memoir. She makes no mention that, you know, Sunda begins his career in Manikudi. Sunda is not Kalki's find. Sunda is not S.S. Vasan's find. Meravi Sundaram wrote his earliest writings in Manikudi between 1934 and 1936. Two or three short stories, two or three essays, five or six poems. So the considering the tension between Manikudi and Ananda Vigadan, Kalki and the Manikudi writers, Meravi Sundaram kind of, you know, soft pedals, or he doesn't mention his own association with the Manikudi group. And I would say that, you know, it gives a very uncharitable interpretation to the criticism of Manikudi writers about Kalki. I think there are much more serious issues involved in this. So this is where I want to add some bit of biographical data about Sunda, you know, man who writes a very important biography. Who is he? What is he? So he said he was born in Melanatham near Tirunelveli. He studied in only up to intermediate. He didn't go to college. Began his career, writing career earlier, very early. Then he joins in those days in the late 30s. All India Radio, Trichy station, attracted young talent. And you know, lots of Tamil writers went there. He went there. He worked there. Then he went to Delhi and also went to BBC later. And he was a very important broadcaster. And only after his retirement, he launched on this biography project. I'll finish in a few minutes. I'm almost done. I have not been able to find when he passed away. his daughter should be able to tell me that. Why I mention his background is that, you know, I also find that, you know, this book, a classic work of great scholarship and industry and energy, if there are some weaknesses, one of the weaknesses is that, you know, it is a, I'd say in a certain, there is a certain conservative outlook to the author. It is not a radical reformist perspective, that critical perspective that you would expect from a, for instance, a Manikudi writer. So that I would say is a weakness. The other weakness I would say is another, so little about the family. I would have liked to know about Kalki's relationship with his wife. I'm sure, you know, Rukmini Amma would have, must have played a very important role in his life. What was he like? So those aspects, the personal is completely missing. Perhaps it is anachronistic to expect something like that from in those days, but that is something that I want to mention. Then there are also the question also of, you know, whether this is a book that can be replaced, it can be superseded. I would broadly say that, you know, it is, this is a book that will stay. It is unlikely to be surpassed. There are a few gaps. One or two gaps that I would like to mention is, there is only one page devoted to the great writer Vindhan. It is very sad because Vindhan owed his writing career to Kalki. In fact, he was so devoted to Kalki, and you know, his gratitude was so big that when he published his journal Manidhan, the first issue was dedicated to Kalki. He published this famous picture of Kalki on his writing table, which does not even have Kalki's name. It says, "Ennai Manidhanakiya Manidhan," to the man who made me a man. And all of Kalki, Vindhan's writings, 80% of Vindhan's writings were published in Kalki, but he gets only one page. Then the other missing thing is, this also ties in with the politics of Manikudi Ananda Vigadan. Ku Alagiri Sami, there is no reference to Ku Alagiri Sami. Ku Alagiri Sami, who is a protege of Pudhumai Pithan, but when he publishes his first collection of short stories, he gets the preface from Kalki. So these are all the kind of gaps. Finally, you know, to wind up, I would say that, why is this Kalki important? Why should we be talking about Kalki? Yes, this is a great book, excellent work, but why should we be worried about Kalki? Kalki, I believe, is a man, a writer, who believed that there should be change and progress in society, especially Indian society, which had fallen on bad times. It should reform itself, it should change itself. That is a message that runs through his writings. It might be very unpopular with the current crop of Indian intelligentsia who cannot find any fault with Tamil Indian society. Everything is right for them. I think Kalki would have been very unhappy if he would see this. He saw writing as a very important instrument of change. If you had told him that writing was only for entertainment, he would have given you a tight slap. So he was critical of all the failings of Indian society. But Kalki made one big mistake. He did a big disservice to himself. What was that disservice? He wrote Ponniyin Selvan, Sivagami in Savadam, and Parthiban Kanavu. It is a tragedy that Kalki is remembered by just these three writings. In my library, I have about 70 to 80 of Kalki's books. And none of them is one of these three volumes. These are good writings, good historical novels, good escapist fare that people should read in their youth. If you read it in your 15th and 20th year, it will give you great pleasure. It will develop a love for language. But Kalki is much more than these historical romances. I hope the publication of the English version of this volume will draw new readers to his other works. And more importantly, I hope Gauri's work translation will not be read by any Tamil person, but only by non-Tamil persons. Let the Tamil readers read Sundar's book. Let readers from outside Tamil Nadu, let them please read this book, and they will realize that Kalki is as important a figure as Premchand, and Sundar wrote a biography which is far superior to the biography of Premchand written by his own son. On this note, I think I've taken a lot of time, but I hope I've done some justice to this monumental and definitive biography of Kalki by Sundar. Thank you very much.